Thank you, St. David's, for having me today. I really appreciate it. My daughter is a third grade student here at your school, and I'm very excited about what you're doing today. I'd like to talk to you today a little bit about disruption, and specifically disruption in media. Media is changing at a rate faster than at any time in history. If you think about how we consume media, it's pretty different than it was even 3 or 4 years ago. If you think about your media usage today, I'd love to see how many people have TV as the number one source for your media, that you spend the most time with TV. Anybody? Can't see you because the lights are blinding me. Nobody? One person. It's okay, I watch TV, I like it. How about the radio or broadcast that is sound-based? Pandora? Spotify? Anyone? No? Facebook? Is Facebook not cool, is it? How about Snapchat? Yeah. Twitter? Yeah. This is what's going on. There are a lot of marketers that really would like to have your attention. And you're spending a lot of your day, heads down, looking at a screen at Snapchat. Pretty hard for them to get to you in that way, isn't it? Or on Twitter. A little easier for them to get to you. They spend a lot of time marketing on Twitter and places like Facebook. But what's really interesting, if you think about what's happening with media today, is media is now driven by you, and it's driven by me, and it's driven by our friends and other people, like people creating content, interesting content, that you consume willingly. Not that you sit back and consume, but you are an active participant of. So I'd like to start with a parable of the carrot, the egg, and the coffee bean. So it was a young woman who was beginning her life in the world, and she came to her mother and she said, you know, gosh, Mom, life is hard. I'm really having trouble making it in the world today. I just don't know what to do. And her mom, very calmly, took three pots of water, placed them on a stove, and brought the water to boil. And in one pot, she put some carrots. Another pot, she put some eggs. In the final pot, she put some ground coffee beans. And she let them come to a boil and cook, and then she took them out and placed the carrots in a bowl, placed the eggs in a bowl, placed the coffee beans in a bowl. And she asked her daughter to touch each one of them, to touch the carrots, to touch the eggs, and actually to drink the coffee. And she did, and she said, Mom, this is great, but what does this mean? She says, well, the carrots, the egg, and the coffee bean all faced an outside force. They faced a force of boiling water. That was their threat. That was the thing that was they were confronted with. And the carrots began strong and firm, and in the face of the boiling water, they became limp and soft, malleable, right? The eggs started fragile then, and in the face of the boiling water, they became hard and rigid. The coffee beans, however, transformed the threat. The coffee beans changed the environment of the threat. And I think it's interesting, when you start thinking about disruption and looking at changing markets, especially in companies and as we talk about media, it's a very similar world that's going on today. There are new media companies that are coming out of the ground that don't work the way traditional media works. They don't operate the way traditional media works. They operate in an environment of the way the end user works. If you think about Snapchat, a company now worth, by some estimates, about $20 billion, Snapchat adapts to the way its user base is using it. It's created longer form stories. is created actually savable. You can actually create lasting Snapchats. And I think it's interesting to think about other forms of disruption in history. It's a gentleman named Bartholomew Roberts. He was a pirate. I like pirates because I think pirates were one of the early folks to look at an economic system and say, hey, you know what? This doesn't really work for me. Bartholomew Roberts was a sailor for the Dutch East Indies Company. And his ship was captured by pirates, and he was given the choice of joining the pirates or being killed. And so joining the pirates seemed like a good choice. And he learned the pirate trade, and he became one of the most successful pirates the world's ever seen. He captured in his lifetime over 470 ships, mostly slave ships, which pirates targeted because they carried gold. And what's interesting about this, we don't think of piracy as being a valid form of economic reality, but for him it was. And it was because he lived in a world that was shaped by a certain set of economic principles, and he chose to take part in a new model. Might not be a model that we agree with, but in a model that nevertheless changed the way that the other companies operated in that time frame. Has anybody seen this movie or read this book, Moneyball? It's one of my favorite movies. Billy Beane, who was the coach of the Oakland A's, Major League Baseball team, with, at the time, the lowest salary by far of all MLB teams. And Billy Beane, there's a scene in the movie and a description in the book where Billy Beane is talking to his scouts and he's talking to the other managers of the team and he's really challenging them to define the problem of the existing situation. And they're giving him answers like, we don't have enough hitters. We don't have the right kind of baseball players. We don't have the strength of pitching that we need. And he keeps challenging them to the point of asking them what the problem is. And finally, one of his folks says, you know, the reality is we're just not very good, which was an understatement. And he has this quote, which I love, there are rich teams, there are poor teams, there are 50 feet of crap, and then there's us, right? And he's really thinking about the problem, and the problem he is able to solve is by looking at why teams win. And he broke this down to math. And really, the factor that he was able to met out that determined who won a baseball game was getting on base. And getting on base a lot of times had nothing to do with the fact that you were a great hitter, or that you were, you know, this picture of what a baseball player should be in people's minds. It was statistically measurable how many times people got on base. And what he realized is there were a lot of really affordable baseball players who got on base more than other baseball players who were getting enormous salaries. And he was able to build a team with these people and take the A's to the World Series that year. Which is pretty cool. It's a great story. How many people use Uber? Uber is solving a really interesting problem. Uber is solving a problem of not only getting people, but potentially getting things from place A to B. Now, a lot of people may look at that market and go, well, it's not a problem. We have taxis, right? Or we have our own cars, or we have many forms of transportation. But Uber is taking advantage of a lot of technology that now brings people and place into a relationship with each other in a way that didn't exist before the technology of the mobile phone. And it's also creating a product out of what was really an excess capacity problem in the taxi and livery industries. And so what Uber has done has made getting me to the airport this morning in Chicago, not something I have to think about until about 30 seconds before I need to go. I don't have to pre-plan. I take out my phone, I push a button, and in 2 minutes, I have a car, I get to the airport, I get out. Uber has disrupted a massive industry in the taxi business to the tune of about $40 billion in valuation today. And it's interesting when you watch these new business models that are coming out of the ground, created by the technology that in the short span of my daughter's life didn't exist when she was born. It's very interesting. Media, more specifically, has this challenge. 85% of people watching TV today also have a second screen. And as I realized watching the NCAA tournament this year, I often had a third screen because I was using a computer, I was using my cell phone to harass Carolina fans. I am a Duke fan, thank you, go Duke. And I was watching a TV, but I spent the least amount of that time watching the TV, for which advertisers are paying billions of dollars of ads on. I couldn't begin to tell you one of them today. And media companies are thinking about, how do I connect these experiences so that I can be part of this conversation? How do I become part of the experience that users are having today with media? And here's some of the interesting things that are going on. This was a couple years ago, Newsweek's last issue, ironically, had a hashtag on the front talking about how this is the last print issue. They've since actually brought the print issue back. But the dollars that are involved in this industry are moving rapidly. And they're not moving to the existing players. They're moving to disruptors. If you look at the dollars that are coming out of the print industry, even when the print industry migrates to digital, they don't go back into the existing players. If you look at the digital revenue that has been generated by newspapers today, it really hasn't changed in about a decade in terms of overall profits, I mean, in terms of overall income. But what has happened is the overall income from those media have transferred to other places, like Google. And again, back to this idea of time spent, digital, this combination of mobile, social, and online, is now the number one place, as we showed earlier, that people are spending their time. So it makes sense. Marketers are smart people, they're data users. If you're spending your time on Snapchat, if you're spending your time on Instagram, I have to figure out a way as a marketer to be part of that conversation without being an uninvited guest to that conversation, which I could very easily be. There's also something that's happening in search today, which is the number one way we find information. We go to Google and search for information about TED Talks. We go to Pinterest and search for information about a great recipe that we could cook for our families tonight. The incidence of search has also flattened. And there's reason driving this is that the way we are finding information is also moving from static channels like Google to Twitter, to Instagram. Twitter is a recency search engine. If I want to know a score of a game, I am more likely to go to Twitter today, because not only am I going to get the score instantly, because people are going to be talking about it, but I'm also going to get some context from people like me, people in my set. And this is a graph that was captured out of an internal New York Times report showing that the inbound traffic to the New York Times homepage has fallen by 50% in just the past year. Doesn't mean that the traffic to the New York Times digital sites has fallen. What it means is people no longer go to the newyorktimes.com to consume content from the New York Times. They're getting that content from Twitter, from Facebook, from other sources. In fact, over the past 3 or 4 months, search and search-driven content has supplanted, socially driven content has supplanted search as the number one referral to other sites, which means that the way we're finding information is coming through new channels. And there are gonna be media that reacts to this. What's happening though, sadly, is marketers are still using the same tactics. Social media, which in its name has a description of how the media works, has become not very much about social for marketers. Social media has become advertising. The dollars that are flowing into social media today are flowing in ad channels, so ads placed within your Twitter stream, on your Facebook page, even in your Instagram, and now Snapchat feeds. I used the word uninvited guest before because a lot of times that content has no relevancy to the things you're talking about, the things you're experiencing on those channels. And we've built a couple models in the past that focuses on the idea of content creators being a new viable media channel to connect with people on these social platforms. The Walmart 11 Moms program was a program that we built back in 2008 that used content creators that were creating content about saving money, Walmart's brand promise. But it was content that was in the form of blogs and in the form of Facebook posts and in the form of tweets that was a new kind of media that we could use. Snapchat, when you think about Snapchat as a media channel, how am I going to be relevant to your Snapchat activities? Does anybody know who this guy is? If you're a Snapchat user, you might follow him. His name's Jerome Jarr. Jerome is a gentleman from France. He now lives in the United States, and he has about 10 million Snapchat followers who consume all of this really quirky and interesting content that he makes. He is now a media property that brands are seeking to engage with in reaching people on this channel in a very organic way. And what's interesting is when we look at the data behind the value of people like Jerome, we're showing really great return on investments. For CPG, every invested dollar is returning $11.33 in return. CPG is consumer packaged goods. We'll try not to use lingo. So we live in Raleigh. Raleigh has just been named as the second best place for a startup outside of Silicon Valley. There are three companies I'd like to share with you very quickly here. You may know some of them. Anybody heard of Steels? Use Steels? Steels was started by a gentleman named Jim Zidar. Jim is a local entrepreneur who has built a company that encourages sharing among users at a restaurant, users at a retail location. Steels is a Raleigh company and growing very quickly using content creators as their primary form of media. Anybody know PhotoFi, John Lanasa's company? PhotoFi is another photo platform that uses geolocation, so you can have a shared experience with people who are at a TEDx event, at a football game, at a basketball game together. PhotoFi is also a Raleigh-based company leveraging content creators. And then finally, our new company that we have launched at South by Southwest last month called Carousel. And Carousel is a media platform that uses combined content creators, people like Jerome Jarr, people who are Instagram content creators and Facebook creators, to create media that's organic and relevant to the property that is being consumed. I appreciate your time today. I hope some of these companies are ones that you learn more about and you think about when you think about how the world is changing in media and people are moving forward with new paradigms in this activity. Have a good day.